Are you going out to help? If you will, come up here real quick, okay? Just for those of you that may not know and haven't got a chance to meet, this is Jacob Plummer. And Jacob is back now, what, 3 weeks or is it? You're not quite a month yet. Back from Brazil. And yes. And next Wednesday night, Lord willing, at this time, same bat channel, same bat time, Jacob and Hannah are going to be bringing their, kind of reporting like Paul did. It said that he went on a missionary journey, came back and shared with the churches what they experienced, what they saw, what they were able to do. And so the two of them are going to be sharing next week on Wednesday night what happened with from the time that they left here, went down to Brazil, what not only they were able to hopefully do for others, but what God did for them and what others did for them. And just to give you perspective and all like that. Plus, I imagine answer a few questions if they got questions.
Oh, yeah,
as long as
bring
it's not like,
bring all your questions.
What was the food that you ate like, you know? And do you have any pan when you were down there?
Water good.
It was the water good, yeah. So, yes. Yeah. They'll answer that next week. So hold all your questions, write them down, man, and thank you very much. All right. Looking forward to it. Let me just, since I won't be here next week with you all, Father and God, tonight, we know that time-wise that we're not there yet, but we know that you live in infinity and that a day is 1,000 years and 1,000 years like a day to you. And God, tonight, just we pray together to you, God, and ask that first of all and most of all, as we seek you, you do what's absolutely best according to your will for the moment and what's to come. But also, Lord, in the midst of that, we pray to you to be released and unleashed, that you would pour your spirit out upon Jacob and Hannah as you did in them going, but that you would allow them to be able to share, Lord, the things that you know will help us back here to understand. Not just about culture, God, but more than that, about you, your word and your spirit. And about, Lord, how sometimes we do things that are risky. We don't do it for the exhilaration of it. We do it because of faith and our commitment to you. But, Lord, I pray that you be building in the two of them what they could share, that even the questions that might need to be asked, Lord, that would open the door for them to share a story that they forgot. And, Lord, that in it, it's not just a show and tell. It's greater than that, God. It's telling and showing you. And telling what you did in them, but also to them. And so I ask in the name of Christ for that. As Lord, I pray tonight too, just that same way with us here. God, same way that you would speak through me, even while you speak to me, that you would, Lord, know each heart that's here and the seed that need to be planted for the future as well as the ones cultivated from the past. In the name of Christ, amen. Thanks, man. Thanks for helping the kids too. Love you. All right, just not that you have to have and need any great explanation, but I usually don't miss unless there's a reason. And this deal here, the primary part of the trip is going to Mayo Sunday after church, after Sunday service. And if we're really fortunate, we'll get out here by 5 o'clock in the evening. But I've got to be at Mayo Clinic 6 a.m. on Monday morning to start tests, 3 days of tests. The third day, we weren't going to be able to get done in time to get back here, and that's when I asked the leadership what they thought, and we were just unanimous about the fact that we would love to hear from Jacob and Hannah. So anybody that you know normally doesn't come, tell them at least so that they could hear, because I think that's pretty tremendous to have, and I say kids with the fondest of heart, but to have a couple of kids, you know, 18, 19 years old that would take off and go to another hemisphere to be willing to not just go for a trip, but rather instead for months. And that's what they did. But anyway, we weren't going to be able to get back. And what we turned out linked together, and the leadership saw that they just said, hey, while you're on the coast, just drive on up. But I got asked by my class and family of a fellow student guy that I graduated with, Kurt, that passed away a few months back. And he was in the military, a lifer in the Air Force, and then went in, worked with the NCIS after that. But he got contract or whatever, the ALS, the Lou Gehrig's disease, and died here a few months back. So his funeral is going to be at Arlington Cemetery on next Friday, not this coming, but the following Friday. And they asked if I would speak. I think it's going to be actually on the base, because when you go to the cemetery, we're going to follow, my understanding is at least, the caisson and the empty horse and full military rites. So that's what's going to be happening. So I ask for your prayers for us, both Mayo, but especially the trip up there, that if God's got something for me to share, to say, that could be able to do that. And I know that what Donna, my classmate, one of the things that she told me was that because we did several things as a class just with verbal messages to Kurt while he still was capable of hearing but not able to communicate back. And his kids went ahead and listened to those too. And so that was a part of his life that they don't know much about, and his wife wasn't a part of that. And so there's some sharing about the things. And Kurt's the one that I baptized between around the freshman year after riding motorcycles together and one thing and all like that. So it's kind of a package thing there, I think, with the whole deal. So if you will, just be praying for us that it be all according to God's plan and what he's got figured out. And then I've got to get back here Saturday for a wedding. So it's just going to be kind of a rammed and jammed vacation. So I keep telling him, we're on vacation, Mayo Clinic and then that, you know. So anyway, if you got your Bibles, if you will, turn back with me to the book of John, chapter 13. Not intending to re-preach this to you, but wanting to remind you of what we've looked at as we kind of go through this thing of, and obviously you've seen that I listened to enough of you that we've, and the leadership felt the same thing, brought it to Sunday morning, the whole idea and the concept of what the Bible gives us that the church is supposed to be. But tonight, this is more about what Jesus said of us as we belong to him and we belong to each other. That's what kind of the pattern that we've gone through looking at the book of Corinthians 12, where it talks about it's one body with many parts. But backing up, trying to understand this love thing that we're supposed to have for each other and how vital and important it is, the litmus test the world will use to determine who Jesus Christ really is. So I know we hit on this. I want to go back and touch on it as I spring into the end of one of Paul's letters to show you a little bit more about how this unity portrays itself, how the church, when it's truly what the church is supposed to be and united, how we are, number one, reconciled, but number two, then we become reconciling agents. Some of you are as old as me, so you may remember. I don't know that I ever really watched the whole movie because at that point in time it was like, eh. Didn't mean anything to me because I was actually young and a teenager, but a movie called Irreconcilable Differences. Remember that one? And the sadness of what I remember about it was parents that were splitting up and the kids going, why? If that was, is that the premise of it? I mean, am I thinking right? But it was, well, we just have these things that we just can't, you know, be able to bring back together. And in their minds is what it oftentimes is. It's not as big a deal trying to tell the kids it's not that big, nothing will change. Well, it changes a lot. And some of you have been through that. And again, this isn't to lay blame or guilt or anything else. It's just that when we're involved with some things, we want to convince ourselves and thus convince others that this won't make any difference. And what God tells us with so many things is whether it's sin or righteousness, it makes a big difference, right? And it's why the scriptures talk a lot about faith and commitment. It's why Jesus' life shows his commitment level. It wasn't only when it was comfortable and it wasn't only when it was cool. It was including when it was torturous, including when it was devastating. He still did what he was called to do. He hung in there for us and his love for us. I share that because we don't talk much about reconciling. It happens when, you know, used to happen at least, when you get your statement from the bank and you compare it to the checks that you wrote, and then it became debit cards and checks. And that's why I don't do the debit card thing, because Julie runs a checkbook and I'll forget something if I do it now. But you would get the statement back and you'd see what the bank said and you'd see what you said, and you'd have to what? Make them work together. They'd have to be reconciled. And this idea of reconciliation is a biblical situation. It's a word that's used, but not just a word, not just a concept, but it's actually what God's ultimate plan was, this reconciliation, bringing two things that were separate together. And you know as well as I do that when it comes to emotions, when it comes to people, when it comes to circumstances, when it comes to feelings, when it comes to perspectives, it's real difficult to reconcile. Police officers face this every day, even if you're just a traffic cop, and not that that's not a big deal, but you have two different people that are involved in this accident, and usually with that you have two different what? Opinions, two different perspectives. And what the police officer has to do is to reconcile from the evidence that's there, the skid marks, whatever else it would be, and sometimes the skid marks and the britches, you figure out who it was that was at fault and who it was that wasn't. But you have to reconcile the whole situation to be able to get a grasp and to determine oftentimes who's right, who's wrong, who's liable, okay? not to go too far with the introduction there, but I share that with you because I don't want to ever just use words and not paint pictures that you can kind of say, oh, that's what you're talking about. Now, Jesus here is explaining about love as we go look, as we have looked, and I just want to point out what we've already looked at before, but verse 14, John 13, verse 14. 34, sorry, Julie. I've got a line through that and it messed it up. But it's verse 34, 13, 34. A new command I give you, love one another. This is what we talked about last week, but it's a command that was new because what? It's one that you can't do on your own. You've got to have Jesus as a part of you and the Holy Spirit in you to do so. He's putting writing a tall enough order that it ought to cause us to go, I can't. And he goes, now you're ready. Now you got the idea. And that's one of the reasons for reconciliation. Since I can't love that godly kind of way on my own, Jesus, come be with me. You know, let me come be with you. And that's what he's describing here. So he said, new command I give you, love one another as I've loved you, so you must love one another. So it's not like there's an option here, not like if you feel like it, not like, well, grow into it. No, it's you're supposed to do this. By all, in fact, here's how important he says, by this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. So I see two things here. Is one, this love that we can't do without Christ. And so he says, that's what I'm saying. I want to partner with you to bring this about. You've got to let me reconcile with you so that we're together in this, not separated. But the great thing is, once the world begins to see that I'm in you and you're in me, and that's what we looked at last week with the Holy Spirit, I'm in you, you're in me, and we're in you, and you're with the Father in heaven as well. Once they see that that reconciliation has happened with a human being and their heart and soul with the Almighty God, that's reconciled, they'll see because of the way you love each other. Once they see that, they'll begin to believe, and that's what he says here, the world will believe that you're mine, you're really following me. Now, if that's the case, and I have a tendency, and I think it's why I was prone towards being a lawyer or whatever, but I have a tendency to say, well, if that is true, then what's the other side of it? The other side is pretty obvious as well. If you don't have this new love, if you've got a love that you can do on your own, the world won't be able to see anything different there because it's a love of convenience, not a love of inconvenience. If you don't have this new love, the world won't believe that you're my disciple. And that's the funny thing, because I don't get people very often coming to me saying, Steve, I'm really concerned about one thing. I'm supposed to have this love, and I just don't have it. Because it's all like, well, you know, yeah, I'm supposed to love. I love. But there's some people really make it difficult. No, it's that love. And what I'm telling you is, this is the coolest thing to me, is the Lord said, here's how easy it is, or how difficult it is, however you want to look at it. It's the way you love that's going to make the world believe that I'm real. If you don't have that kind of love, they won't believe. But nowhere is included within this me coming to you saying, you need to love me more. It's not that at all. It would be the child that because mom and dad's disciplining them, say, you need to love me more. You're not loving me enough. No, you don't know how difficult this is. I really want to smack you, but I'm not. You know, I'm just kidding. But you know, if you only knew how much I really love you, because it would be easier for me to let you do what you want to do than it is to have the tough love that says no. And so within this, then, I think it's so huge to see that Jesus would literally boil it down to make it pretty simple, that it's a new kind of love, one that you don't have capacity to do without me and the Holy Spirit. It's a love that is so powerful that when you have it for each other and for me, for Jesus, not me, Steve, but Jesus, when you have it for me, it will prove to you that you not only believe in me, but you follow me. That's what a disciple is, a follower with the intention of learning. It's not just a believer. It's been too watered down for that. No, you're really my kind of disciples. And remember elsewhere where Jesus said, if you want to follow me or be my disciple, you need to die to yourself daily. And that's what it's all about. It's getting rid of the Steve Pettit kind of love and beginning to have the Jesus Christ kind of love. But not just trying or attempting, but rather instead, from the power of the Holy Spirit within me, letting God transform me so that I can. But that total reconciliation that happens because of the love of Christ, his love now is transferred into me if I'm willing to allow him now to use me. All right? Then in chapter 17 and 14 talks about how the Spirit's going to work in us, but 17 then is one we looked at 2 weeks ago, down at verse 20. And it's where Jesus says his prayer after talking to them and explaining. And all this is happening his last night on earth, alive, free, Because the next 24 hours later is when he goes through this, not even full 24 hours, but where he goes through the cross, the whole trial, mistrials actually, and the Garden of Gethsemane, goes through that, and he's arrested, taken in, whipped, beaten, all these things, and then crucified. And by 6 o'clock then the next day, so it would have been after this time here, he's already dead. So this is the last, not even 24 hours of his life. So these teachings to me make me kind of play German Shepherd and perk up my ears a little bit more, because these are the words of a dying man before he's actually dying. His disciples aren't paying attention with pointed ears because, come on, he's Jesus. That's the whole thing. We're waiting for this king that's going to live forever. But Jesus in his heart is broken. And that's why you go back and read the beginning of chapter 14. It says, don't let your hearts be troubled, but trust in God, trust in me. And he's telling them that because he's saying, you all don't understand what's about to happen, but you are going to have troubled hearts unless you know where to place your faith. All right? So as he does this, and he tells about the Holy Spirit, the ministry of it, as he talks about branches of Christ, abide in me and you'll bear much fruit. If you don't, you won't, and I'll cut you off. Now then he's getting into this thing where he actually stops in and he prays for them. And we don't see his prayers written out very often. This is, chapter 17 is far more the true, honest, genuine Lord's Prayer than what the Our Father who art in heaven is. That was a model prayer. This is the Lord's Prayer. I'm not going to take time to take you through all of it, but I do want to go back and review what we looked at that he prayed for us, for you and me, even before we were ever born. Verse 20, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their messages. Woohoo! That's you and me. Because they took what Jesus had taught them and they continued to teach it and live it out, because they continued to be his disciples even after Jesus left this earth. They continued to follow him with the intention of learning more. Because of that, we got the message. 1900 years later, we get the message. And we believe in Jesus because of their message. So my prayer is not for them alone. I pray for those who will believe in me through their message. Next verse. Thank you. That all of them may be one, Father. What's he praying? That we're all going to be so absolutely united and morphed together, so reconciled, one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may, here we go again, believe you've sent me. So earlier he said, by this love, all men will know that you're my disciples. They'll believe because of the seeing this love demonstrated that's outside of the human nature. But not only that, but as they see our unity, they will believe that Jesus Christ was really sent from God the Father to this earth. That's what you and I possess, is the capacity. I mean, I heard today when I was coming back from the hospital, I heard Sean Hannity on, and it was a gal doing the deal about, why do we have to say, one nation under God, what's the big deal with that? And so he was going into his field. And it was pretty decent, but I mean, I could just tell it was a hostile kind of an environment. I mean, she wasn't looking for reasons to believe, but she was just, her whole premise was, if God were real, why do children and animals suffer? Well, she's starting from the wrong place, and he was trying to get her to go back further, but that's just a real difficult, not impossible, but there's got to be a relationship there to explain, is what I would tell you. I just try to weigh out a situation. There's some that it's just like, we don't have enough of a relationship. All we're going to do is argue, and I don't want to argue, I'll give you why I believe what I do, but nonetheless, Jesus is saying here, don't worry about all those arguments. Let me tell you what. If you guys are united, the world will believe there's a God. Now, whether that's me within myself united with Christ, whether that's me with Julie united in our marriage and that commitment to each other because of Christ, or whether that's Julie and I together united with you as a church because of our commitment to Christ, or it's you and your marriages and you and your relationships, you and your families. But basically, it's more than just a typical traditional unity. No, this is a special unity that God, when we are one, God is willing to give them such a picture that they will believe in Jesus, and that they'll believe that the Father has actually sent his Son to this earth because it made such a difference. That, in my mind, is pretty huge. What about you? That the proof text, and this is the amazing thing, I've heard very, very smart men and wise men and tremendous preachers argue with the guys like, I can't even think of what the smartest guy on earth is supposed to be now, what his name is. They may know offhand this, huh? Yeah, Stephen Hawking. Smartest man on earth, you know. Preachers arguing with that and trying to present their case, stuff like that. And yet Jesus said, no, man, you don't have to be the smartest man or the best preacher or anything. All you got to do is be so surrendered and united, reconciled with me that you're so united with each other, the world will believe that God sent his son to this earth. I love that. So again, though, the lawyer in me says, so if that's true, then the opposite is also probably true. If you don't have that kind of love, the world won't believe. So I hope you understand the reason I'm preaching this isn't just to tell you all, love harder now, love better. No, it's to say, first of all, where I'm at, God, I can't unless you do it in me and your spirit. Secondly, it's not about performance. It's allowing God to be so through us that it happens. But within that, to discover that that's what the mission of the church is supposed to be. Because everybody gets scattered and smothered and covered with all these things the church is supposed to do. Shouldn't we be passing out water? Well, that's a good thing to do. There's nothing wrong with that. Shouldn't we be saving the lost? Let's have a big revival or fill up the Brave Stadium and have a revival. Wouldn't that be pleasing to God? Well, that's not going to be unpleasing to God. But, you know, well, shouldn't we feed the poor and the hungry? Yes. Shouldn't we, you know, Christmas, let's give everybody a gift for Christmas. Isn't that what God would want? And again, all those things are good. But there's not one of those that says in there what this says, that the world will believe in the Father and the Son because of the way we're unified by them. So, again, if I'm going to play devil's advocate and be the devil, guess what I want to do to the church so that the world won't believe? Get them distracted with 1,000 different good things so they don't do the godly thing. So our question personally, yours and mine, to God ought to be, am I focused, is your main thing my main thing, God? I want the world to believe in you, Lord. I want to be completely reconciled with you and in unity with you, but I can't just be satisfied with that. I've got to have unity and be reconciled with my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ too, or the world won't believe that you were sent. I believe that that's this huge. The reason, again, dying words of a dying man. I want to blow this up with how huge this is. These are some of Jesus' last words, and other than his personal private prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane, his last prayer for those that believed and were already following him, and as he prayed for those of us that would yet believe. So let's go back and read that all together again, Julie, verse 20. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, or united, just as you are me and I am you, that we can be united to the point that the Father and the Son are. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one. So we have the ability, we may be one. We have the permission, I should say, I guess, may be one as we are one. I and them, you and me. So Jesus and who? Us and me and you. Jesus and us. The Father and Jesus. May they be brought to not just unity now, it's complete unity. Guess what another word for complete is? Perfect. It's a strange word that way. It's easy to misunderstand because we think perfect meaning perfection. And what the Bible typically means instead is this picture of completion. It's finished. Jesus on the cross. That was perfect. It was ugly and it was bad, but it was perfect. It was completed. May they be brought to a complete or a perfect unity. That's you and me again, guys, the church, to let the world know. Here's that word again, that they would see and experience that you sent me and have loved them even as you've loved me. Nowhere in here does he say so that they can go out and put their finger in their faces and say, you got to believe in God. No, it says they'll believe in God when you and I put our fingers in our own face and say, Lord, help me to love like you loved. Help me to be united with my church. Help me to be united with my brothers and sisters in Christ in a complete way so that the world will say, this is phenomenal. You can't do that as normal human beings. So again, the devil's going to be over here trying to pull that to pieces and unravel it, number one, or he's going to try to corrupt it, number two, And the reason I believe that there are so many divisions in the church isn't because that was God's design and all these names and who's first and second and third and all this stuff, is because the devil knew if he could fracture us and get people to, well, we're more holy because we believe this and don't do that. Well, we're more holy because we believe this and do that. Do you see how it works? And so the world ends up looking and going, you guys are a bunch of jerks. You can't even make up your mind about what Jesus wants. You all think you all know. And I'm not standing here tonight like I know. I'm just standing here tonight saying, hey, I'm just some dumb farm kid from Illinois, and I can tell you, this is pretty simple. It's deep theology, but it's simple theology. It's the basis of what Christianity is really about. Jesus in us, God in Christ, complete unity. The world believes, they know, and it's that light bulb, ding, oh, wow. There's something different about those folks. But they believe you sent me and have loved them. They'll begin to believe that they are loved by God by the way we love each other. Anybody here tonight, do you love way too much? Okay, I would love for you to come up and take my place because I don't have that problem. I want to limit my love. And by that, what I mean is it's the most natural thing. I love the people that like me. If you don't like me, go ahead, fly your own kite. You know, I don't care. No, that's not what this talks about. I still love you. And don't get me wrong, I've grown, but I'm certainly not there. But man, I certainly have that as my goal. I want to get there. How about you? I mean, because the truth is, folks, what this is saying is that because of our selfishness, meaning that I don't want to increase my capacity to love, because I'm putting limits because of so-and-so and what they did, what they said, that what I'm actually doing is saying, I don't care if the world goes to hell, I don't have to love them. Well, we'd never say that out loud, but it's what we're saying with our actions. I only want to love the people I like, and that's not what this is saying. And then the other part then comes into with Satan qualifying that and everything that way. But I just think that this is huge. I think it's marvelous. I think that it's like, oh, that makes it easy, right? Let's make sure that the world knows. And I don't know how far to go with this because, I mean, to me it's like, well, let's just read the rest of it and see what it says here. So, Father, I want those that you've given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory that you have given me because you love me, even what? Before the creation of the world? So before Adam and Eve, before Garden of Eden, before God said, let there be light, he already had the plan, and this was put in place for that glory to be given. And now God, Jesus is asking God that he would turn around and now share that glory with you and me. And believe me this, that in God's eyes, it is glorious when we are united, not because we have so much in common, not because we like each other, but simply because his Holy Spirit is in us. And number two, we are so committed to Christ that get out of the way any differences there are, because I'm going to love you no matter what. Same way with a husband and wife, that none of us have a perfect relationship because it's without flaw. We have perfect because it's complete, a complete commitment that we're together no matter what. And when you take divorce off the table, when you take all these other things, I'll love you as long as, or but ifs and whatever else, you take that off the table, that's when the world begins to see that, wait, you can't be separated. Doesn't mean we can't injure each other in multiple ways, but if the commitment is there, and that's what he's wanting. So, Father, I want those you've given me to be with me where I am. See my glory, the glory you've given me, because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I do. And they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love that you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. Now, this is the cool part here. And this is what I'm excited about you being here tonight is, this is how he will continue to make it known. Very few of us, if any of us, including myself, would have studied this passage out if we'd have stayed home tonight. Because it's a lot easier to turn on the TV than it is to open the Bible. And it's a lot easier to watch TV than it is not just to read the Bible to make any sense out of it or to be challenged by it. Because typically we read it and go, okay, that's what it says. Okay, I made him know. No, no. But we never break it down. But man, I think this is so cool. Jesus saying, I've made you known to them. And even though I'm leaving this place, I'm going to continue to make you known in order that the love that you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. How do we get more Jesus in us? By continuing. Continuing with our commitment, a faith that begins and keeps on, that believes and keeps on believing. Not even the same level, keeps on increasing in that belief. Everything that God asks us to do or that Jesus told us that we should do in him, whether it's faith, whether it's love, whether it's serving, all of it is you begin it and you continue it with greater emphasis. And what Paul goes on to say, and we probably won't get into that tonight, is, but that's how we get to know the Lord. It's by doing what he told us to do, but by doing what he told us to do, it's not just accomplishing the task, it's that we've realized, I can't do this without you. And that's what he says, I'm delighted, let me come in and be in you then. I'll help you do this. It's by not picking and choosing whether we're going to teach that class or we need to help out with this event or do something that way. Instead, it's like knowing that God's saying, hey, you can do that. And you're going, but I don't like doing that. I don't feel like I can do that because last time I tried to do that, it didn't work so well. And I don't know. And he said, did you try it with me or without me? And folks, I'm telling you, it makes all the difference in the world. I may not be the greatest preacher, but I'll guarantee you one thing. You don't want to hear me preach without Jesus. Sometimes it's an endurance with Jesus in me, you know, but imagine what it would be like without. I've listened to some preachers that preach without Jesus. I mean, polished messages, everything that way. But man, it's like Paul said in Timothy, told Timothy in chapter 2 Timothy 3, they have a form of godliness, but no power. I know that some of you have sensed the power. It's not me. You know that. I'm so dumb and so off the wall and gross out king and everything else like that and Lance Romance. I mean, I can't be Jesus too, except and unless Jesus is in me. And that's what he wants to be in all of us. So one of the greatest ways to get to know Jesus is by stepping out to do something that he's called you to do that you can't do on your own. And it's in that experience of it you begin to realize, man, I really am reconciled with Christ. He helped me there. And I didn't even like doing what I was doing until I was done with it. And then it's like, that wasn't so bad. I mean, I can't begin to tell you the bodily functions that I feel before I preach. Because inside I'm going, this is ridiculous, Lord. I'm going to make such a fool out of me, and I'm really afraid I'll make a fool out of you. But God, if you want me to, okay, I'm going to do it again since the first Sunday I ever preached. And I share that with you because, folks, I want you to know Christ. I want you to continue to know him so that in you knowing him, and this is an experiential knowledge. It's not just a mental awareness. It's an experiential. It's like you experience him in you, that you continue in that. Man, the love of Christ will pour out of you because suddenly you realize it's not just you anymore. It's you with him so united that you bleed the same blood. That's what he wants. That's why when we take communion, we take the body and the blood of Christ. That's why when we take it, that we take it within. And I don't believe it's that we're cannibalistic or whatever, but it's instead that we are symbolizing that whole picture of Jesus in me and then through me. But instead, we want to be the kindergarten kid down there that goes, I got Jesus in my heart. Oh, that's so sweet. And I'm not making fun of kindergartners that got Jesus in their heart. But I'm telling you what, Jesus doesn't want to be in your heart. He wants to be through your entire being. And getting to heaven's not about having Jesus in your heart, like Barney on your underwear, you know? It's not like that. Getting to heaven is all about not just having Jesus in your heart, it's throughout you, your entire being. Flesh and blood will not inherit the kingdom. So your heart, your hands, it won't be that. But he will work through them if he's in your soul. But it's the completedness of that too that will let the world know. Next verse then, Julie, please. Hang on to what? Okay. Is that the next verse? That was the end of it? I'm sorry. Okay. I should have looked at my real Bible here instead of the screen Bible. I thought we had one more verse. Okay, we don't need to look at that one. Now you can go to the next verse that I did tell you, though. If you will, make your way over to the book of Ephesians. That's the one that begins with an E. That's what we call it, Ephesians. And it was actually not the name of a church. It was a church that was in the city of Ephesus. Ephesus, that is also known as Turkey. before they ate them for Thanksgiving. But no, the book of Ephesians here, it's I've got so much to tell you about this book, but I'm going to save it for Sunday morning because it's not just about this book, but about this church, because it's phenomenal the amount of information we've got. And as I told you, the book of 1 Corinthians, if I was to rename it, I'd call it the book of selfishness or the book on selfishness in the church. If I was to rewrite the book or to give a title to Ephesians instead of just the place that or that this church existed and was written to, I don't know, there's several, because one, it talks a lot about the riches in Christ. And for any of us that, you know, are kind of like razzled and dazzled and would love to win the lottery, man, this book tells you the true riches that are eternal that we have in Christ. But I would probably say the church that almost did. Because it's one of the saddest things to read all there is about the church at Ephesus and how they had it all and never got it. So as you read it, just keep that in the back of your mind. And like I said, Lord willing, on Sunday, maybe I'll get into some of this, because as we talk about the bride of Christ, I think this book tells a lot about it. What I wanted to look at here in the book of Ephesians, chapter 1 here, let's go ahead and pick it up with verse 3. And the first part just says it's Paul and it's written to the saints. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. In whom? Christ. I love that. In Christ. For he chose us in him. Remember how we just looked about the Father and his glory before the creation of the world? Look at this one. He, God, put the big square box around the he there, chose us in him, square box again, before the creation of the world. Okay, how'd that happen? I really don't know. I mean, there are all kinds of theories. Where are we entities, souls, beings in heaven just sitting there waiting to be put in a body to sent down to the earth or whatever? I don't know, man. I don't know. Or is it just because of God's omniscience, his omniscience, meaning a knowledge that goes out and there is no end to it, that he knew we would exist before we ever existed? Now, that's the basis of God, and that's the basis of salvation. That's what a lot of people misunderstand. They think because the Ten Commandments didn't work, God had to come back with plan B. No, man, the cross was plan A from the get-go. And so it's huge to know this, too. God chose us in him. He picked us to be of him and to be reconciled completely to him, united with him before the creation of the world. Why did he have to let the devil be there? I think it's all because of the devil. I think God planted earth to get the devil's attention. I think he planted you and me and Adam and Eve on the earth to get the devil's attention. I think God made us these quote-unquote free moral agents where we have choices. We can reason, we have choices. And we choose to make choices, including sin. And that God showed the devil, see, just like you did in heaven, they did here on this earth in this utopia. But watch this, I'm still going to reconcile them. I'm not going to let them eat from the tree of life, so I'm getting them out of the garden. I am going to make them realize that now that you've let sin enter, there's going to be other things that go with it, which is what I would have told this lady that was on the radio today if she'd asked me, well, how can there be a God if he allows little children and animals to suffer? It's, yeah, he may allow it, but it's not his fault. Man was the one that chose to sin, and we still are. We just like to believe, well, my sin doesn't make anybody suffer. You're a liar to yourself if that's what you believe. There is no sin that you can commit that will not hurt you, and there is no sin that you commit that doesn't hurt others that you can't even yet see. There are hereditary spirits and sins that somewhere along the line we got to let Jesus arrest and stop and say, no more. And that's what happens as we go through life. We begin to discover things, but that's a whole other thing. But God knew us before the creation of the world, and he picked us. He chose us. Now, some take it to the point that we don't have a choice. I don't believe that. But he chose us to be holy and blameless in his sight. How can we do that when we're such sinners? Because that's how great his grace is. He chose us to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as sons through Jesus Christ. In other words, it was his plan. I think that all men, like it says elsewhere, will be without excuse. Nobody will be able to say, no, God existed. No, he will make it plain through circumstances, situations, nature, and people. And so he predestined us. In other words, he put everything in our path that we could not escape seeing Jesus. Some way, somehow. He predestined us to be adopted as his sons. Now, I really like the fact, and it's confusing, but it's not. He's just trying to give every single, you know, facet of the diamond that our life is to him. But here he talks about adopting us. Elsewhere he talks about being born again and through conception and everything that way. Why would he use both of those things? Well, because one, this one never is an accident, right? Oh, I've never met the couple that said, yeah, we accidentally adopted a kid. You know, he showed up and we accidentally adopted. No, man, when you adopt somebody, you go through great pains and usually quite a bit of money to do so, and it's out of desire, and knowing even then you don't know all that's behind that. But the devil works on adopted kids more than any others to make them feel as though they don't belong. And there's nothing that has broken my heart any more than watching a child that, man, the parents bent over backwards adopting and then to be rejected. But that's a part of what goes with it when you have that kind of love. And that's the kind of love that God's got. He adopted us even knowing that some would still say, I don't want your silly adoption. I'm going to do life my way. But he adopted us, his sons, through Jesus Christ, through whom Jesus, don't leave him out of it, in accordance with, I love this, his, and if you weren't here before, like in my Bible, this would have a square box around it. Every time that it's a, or Jesus Christ would have a square box around it, or at least a rectangle. And I do that to highlight when it's talking about God, in any the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, okay? But it was in accordance with his square box pleasure and his will. In other words, God adopting us wasn't this poor son of a gun and slobs that they are. I guess somebody's got to do something with them. You know, they screwed up again. So, I don't know, Jesus, what do you think we ought to do? Well, let's adopt them, Dad. You know, they're going to be more hassle than they're worth. It'd be true, right? I mean, there's something, I think every child gets to kind of that point, right? Is it really worth it, you know? But it is because you love them and hope for their love to come back. But God had pleasure and will. That's hard for me to reconcile in my mind with the cross. The cross that he showed us he couldn't love us more. It's not that he couldn't care less. No, he couldn't love us anymore. It was his pleasure and will. That's what kept Jesus on the cross, was knowing this was their agreed upon plan before the creation of the world. That's why he's wrestling the garden that night, and it's not because I don't want to do this thing now. I changed my mind. It wasn't changing his mind. He's just wanting to be absolutely certain, God, this is the time and this is the place. Because after this is done, Peter and James and John and these other guys over here, man, he said, if they don't carry it on, it dies. We got it. You did a good job teaching. You discipled them. It will work. It will work, son. This is the time. And so Jesus never uttered another peep about that again. Not once do we see him dancing around with the trial. Do we see him dancing around when he's being pummeled or when he's being whipped or when he's being crucified? Does he ever dance around with God again? It's in his mind. It's that this is the will of God. It is our pleasure and will. And I think it takes both of those, because if you're like me, at least, there's some times that I have to will it because I'm not enjoying it. Is that fair? But there are times that it's real easy. You don't even think about having to will it because you're enjoying it. But God and the Holy Spirit looked at this whole plan of salvation and they said, man, let's go do this. Let's adopt these kids, that nobody, these orphans that nobody else would want. And it is our pleasure as well as our will to do so. Next, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. So God gave us his glorious grace in Jesus. And he did love Jesus, but he doesn't love Jesus any more than he does us. And that's not fair. Am I right? That is not fair, but you can take it to the bank. Next passage, please. In him, the him square box, we, you and I, have redemption. And redemption is like the old school days when you used to lick those sticky stamps and put them in there and then lick some more and put them in there. And man, your tongue would get so lick and stick that, you know. But as kids, we thought it was good. Oh, this tastes good. And it did for the first two pages. And after that, it was like, forget it. But we put those together and have those S&H green stamps. And then we could take, if you got a boatload of them, you could take them in and trade them for a toaster, you know. That's how redemption worked. You get stamps when you buy gas, you get stamps when you buy groceries, and you put them together in these books and you change them out for prizes that you would like to have. The word still means the same. In him we have redemption through his blood. So instead of stamps, it took the blood of Christ. But in him we have this complete redemption through his blood, the complete forgiveness of sins, plural, in accordance with the riches of God's grace. There's that word, riches of God's grace. And man, that is much. And he lavished it upon us. Best way I can describe lavished is it's the difference between just in water and you're trying to wipe off versus a bubble bath or soap that just lathers up. I mean, it's that kind of picture that it's not, oh, here you go. It's, no, you've got plenty. He lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. This is the cool part. In other words, even knowing that we would still struggle after we had forgiveness, even knowing that we would sometimes doubt, even knowing that we would get ourselves into messes that only he could clean up, he still, with that wisdom and understanding, the Father and the Son, the Holy Spirit still were in agreement, it's worth it. That's why my elbows go out when somebody tries to say, how could a good God do it? And I'm like, oh, if you only knew and realized that you breathing is God loving. Because I am thankful he doesn't treat me like my sins deserve. Even before Jesus Christ and my acceptance of him, God does not treat me like my sins deserve. Even after Christ, God has not treated me like my sins deserve. It's because not only does he have the wisdom, but the understanding, he knows that we are, as the psalmist says, but dust. And the little kid looked at his grandma and said, the preacher just said but. Thinking B-U-T-T dust, butt dust, you know? No, we're all butt dust. We're just dust, you know? I mean, God understands that. And it's not like that's okay or that's why he gives us a pass. It's that's why he poured out his blood and his grace for us. Okay, so he lavished on us. And he made known to us, and this is the part I wanted to get to that I'm about running out of time on. He made known to us. He, God, made known to us, Christians in the church, Gentiles and Jews, the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure. There's that word pleasure again. God, and why would I say this? Because I'm finding out that I die to self and give Jesus more room to work, that there are things that bring me pleasure that don't have any earthly significance at all. It's not a pleasure that's like, oh man, like a rush that I love. It's not like taking a gun and shooting up holes all over a target. It's not like riding my motorcycle as fast as it will go. No, it's a different kind of pleasure. It's the kind that says, I hate it. It's the garage sale, yard sale, whatever you call it. I hate it. I despise it. I loathe it. I just, why would we ever even think about doing again? I don't care how much money. Well, I do. I'm a preacher. But, you know, it's like, but in the midst of it, there is a pleasure. That's a taste of what God, according to his good pleasure, in spite of the taste of bitterness and the blood in Jesus' mouth and the horrific thing to me it would be as a father if I watched my son being pummeled and sacrificed the way he was, God still found pleasure because of what he hoped would happen. Moms and dads, you've got to have a picture of this. Am I right? You endure not just the nighttime feedings and boo-boos on the knees and the sickness and changing sheets three times in one night because your kid can't get to the wastebasket or whatever, you know? I mean, you don't, because you enjoy it. It's a pleasure, but at the same time, it becomes a pleasure because you so love those kids. Yes? And even when they grow up and get older, you get frustrated, but you're not even as mad at them as you are themselves. Fair? You hope for them better than you've had, you know? That's this, our God, according to his good pleasure, he purposed, or he proposed in Christ, but he purposed in Christ. That was the whole idea of it. It's in God's nature that he wants to, through Christ, bring this about. It's his pleasure through the death of Christ, but also through the hardship that Christ faced, that we would get it and that we would overcome not only our sins, but we would even overcome that nature, that we would begin to experience God in us. And then we could make known God, join with God. Thank you, yes. That he made, just get rid of it. And he, speed reader, and he made known to us then the mystery of his will. And this is an interesting phraseology, I guess you could say, the mystery of his will, meaning that God didn't let Adam understand, and even Abraham, God got to go ahead and to kind of test his faith by, how bad do you want a son, Abraham, or Abram? And yet Abram believed God, okay? But even then, Abram didn't have any idea about why. Your descendants will be as numbers as star, numerous as the stars in the sky, sand on the seashore. His mystery, and the mystery here is, it's like a good mystery. You whether reading a book, you're watching TV or movie, it's like you're trying to figure it out, right? And it takes a while for it to all come together. And so every time to the cross, nobody even began to fathom. And it's almost as if I think that God had to keep it that way so that the devil himself was caught off guard, because the devil thought that with the cross, he stopped whatever God was doing. And the truth was, he did exactly what God needed him to do. I mean, I don't know about you. I like a good mystery. I like it when it's got me going, wow, you know, how did they come up with that? You know, but this is one where he caught Satan clear back on his heels and bowled him over, because Satan thought, I just killed the Son of God. And God and Jesus knew what you had to do so that salvation could be complete. The mystery of his will. But it wasn't just using Jesus to pay for sins, but it's this whole picture that now that he's paid for the sins, and what this goes on to say, like I said, I'm running out of time here, is that Jews and Gentiles are reconciled, and that Abraham being the father of faith is no longer Abraham being an Israelite. It's Abraham being those whose faith is in God. And that even like Jacob, who was the first one to ever wear the name Israel, Israel actually means, Jacob meant what? You remember? Deceiver. When he wrestled with God that night, it became Israel. And Israel means one who wrestles with God. And what I really like about that is, it's even you and me. If you've quit wrestling with God, I probably want to say shame on you. Because I doubt that he's completely conquered you yet. For me, it's still a wrestling match. And I know God wins. I don't know why I even wrestle, you know, there's no sense, but it's my mind and my heart and my body continually surrendering again. But anyway, Jacob became Israel by wrestling with God because he wouldn't let God. And that's what we've got to be, are those that won't let go of him. But this mystery of his will, according to all this, is that Jews and Gentiles get reconciled. God, who is the holiest of holies, and you and I that are the sinfulest of the sinners, we're united. All that was God's will, that blood had to be shed. Not just a pinprick, but no, drained out, being the innocent lamb. Anyway, the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he proposed in Christ. But isn't that amazing we could even call that good pleasure? But it's, again, like the parent taking care of the child, no matter how old or young they are. There's a good pleasure to it because, like the song Henry led us in tonight, it's who he is. It's who he is. And it becomes who we are. Right? It becomes who we are. Not out of scriptures, but Lord willing, we can pick it up here. What's verse 10, Julie? Let me finish that one up. To be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment. Yeah, this is what I wanted you to see. See this picture? To bring all things in heaven and earth together under one head, even Christ. That's what you and I as individual Christians, you and I collectively as a church, all the Christians collectively in our churches that form a church, that's what the world is supposed to be. They're supposed to be able to see in us that God has brought about such a unity that all things in heaven and earth are together under one head, that Jesus Christ is our Lord. Not that we just go, yeah, Jesus is the Lord. No, he is my Lord. He is the Lord of lords and the King of kings. He is the Lord of all. All that I've got, all that there is, and the whole thing is when the times will have finally reached their complete fulfillment, when the second coming comes, it will be very clear who is under Christ and who is not. And either we chose to be reconciled to him or we will find out that we're rejected by him because we rejected him. And so as we go into communion tonight, this idea of Christ, that's why we celebrate communion. That's why we pray to God through Christ. That's why we go back to the Bible, even though we're looking at verses you've heard before. It's so that we don't get dulled down by the world around us and we begin to get sloppy with our faith or with our love that we're supposed to have, but we sharpen it, we increase it, we allow him to build it, we get closer to Christ so that Christ is more through us. It's why we have to keep shifting out of what I have to do regularly is I have spent 37 and a half years trying not to let preaching and ministry be my job. You know, but that's what you do. But I don't want it to be my job because a job implies task-oriented, doing it because of the money. I don't want it to be that way. I want it to be my calling. I want it to be my worship of Christ. And the same way with you being a Christian, I want the same thing. I don't want coming to church to be your obligation or your duty. And I did D-U-T-Y. But I said duty, I know. I don't want it to be your duty because it becomes like duty if you're doing it for that. I want it to be because it's your calling. I want it to be because in your heart you want to get to know Christ in his fullness. I want it to be, God, I don't love enough. I need more of you in me. How do I do that? And it's through his word. And it's then the surrender. It's that repentance. It's that confession. Lord, I can't unless you do it with me. Okay. What do I have to do to get out of your way so that you can be in me? What is there that's in me that's keeping you from being effective? Holiness or lack of it. And that's, folks, what it's about. And that's why I said repentance is supposed to be just a second nature to us, not taking it for granted, not just not avoiding repentance, but rather instead indulging ourselves in the repentance to come back to Christ because we don't want him to have wasted a drop of his blood on that cross, right? We say it means the world to us. Well, let's show him it means everything to us. And if these are the things that he wants to come forth from us, and if unity is it, by golly, let's work on unity then. So that we're united in Christ, so that the world will believe that there's a God again. But as long as we're scattered, smothered, and covered, they'll go, you're just like the rest of us. Your club can't get along well either. So, if you'd like to take communion tonight,